In this video, we are going to see about the parotid gland. So before going to in detail, we'll see what are the boundaries for the parotid region, which forms the mold or the bed for the parotid gland. In front, the posterior border of the ramus of the mandible with the masseter muscle and the medial pterygoid attached to the bone. Behind, by the mastoid process of the temporal bone and the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Above, by the external acoustic meatus and the posterior part of the temporomandibular joint. Below, by the posterior belly of the digastric muscle and the stylohyoid muscle. Medially, it is formed by the styloid process and the muscles attached to it. So these are the boundaries of the parotid region, which forms the mold or the bed for the parotid gland. Now we'll see about the parotid gland. It is the largest of the three paired salivary gland. Each gland is a shape of inverted pyramid and it weighs about 25 grams. Since the gland is casting over the parotid mold, some parts of the gland extend beyond the mold and forms the various processes of the gland. Next, we'll see the coverings. The coverings are two. You have a true capsule, which is formed by the condensation of the fibrous stroma. Then you have the false capsule, which is formed by the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. So between the angle and the mastoid process, the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia divides into a superficial layer and a deep layer. The superficial layer covers the superficial surface of the gland and gets inserted to the lower border of the zygomatic arch, and it blends with the epimysium of the masseter muscle and forms a strong parotidomastoid fascia. The deep lamina is thin and attached to the tympanic plate and the styloid process of the temporal bone. And this part is thickened to form the stylomandibular ligament, and the ligament extends from the tip of the styloid process to the angle of the mandible, which separates the parotid gland and the submandibular salivary glands. Now we'll see the presenting part. So this is the apex of the gland and this is the base of the gland. And you have three surfaces: a superficial surface, this is the anteromedial surface, this is the posteromedial surface. So three surfaces: a superficial surface, anteromedial and the posteromedial surfaces. This is a diagrammatic representation to show you the presenting parts of the parotid gland. So this is the apex of the gland, this is the base of the gland, and this is the superficial surface, what you are seeing, superficial surface, and this is the anteromedial surface, and this is the posteromedial surface. The borders are, this is the anterior border, which separates the superficial surface from the anteromedial surface, and this is the posterior border, which separates the superficial surface from the posteromedial surface, and this is the medial border, which separates the anteromedial and the posteromedial surfaces, and sometimes this border is called as the pharyngeal border when it is related to the walls of the pharynx. So now we'll see what are the structures that passes through the apex of the gland. So the cervical branch of the facial nerve, the anterior division of the retromandibular vein, and the formation of the external jugular vein. So these are the structures which passes through the apex of the gland. Now we'll see about the base of the parotid gland. The base of the parotid gland is concave and related to the external acoustic meatus and the posterior part of the temporomandibular joint. Now we'll see what are the structure passing through the base. So first is the temporal branch of the facial nerve. Then you have the superficial temporal vessels. Then you have the auriculotemporal nerve. So these three structures emerges through the base. The temporal branch of the facial nerve, the superficial temporal vessels and the auriculotemporal nerve. Now we'll see about the superficial or lateral surface. So this is covered by the skin. Then you have the superficial fascia. Then you have the posterior fibers of the platysma muscle. And then you have the superficial lamina of the parotid sheath, that is formed by the investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. So this is also has the superficial group of parotid lymph nodes and the branches of the great auricular nerve, which supplies the skin over the angle of the mandible. So next we'll see about the anteromedial surface. So this is the anteromedial surface. So this surface is deeply grooved by the ramus of the mandible and presents the following relations. So it is related to the posteroinferior part of the masseter muscle, the posterior border of the ramus of the mandible and the capsule of the temporomandibular joint, the medial pterygoid muscle near its insertion, the outer lip of the groove transmits the branches of the facial nerve, and the inner lip of the groove transmits the maxillary artery medial to the neck of the mandible. Next, we'll see about the posteromedial surface. So this posteromedial surface is extensive and it comes in contact with the following structures: the mastoid process with the sternocleidomastoid muscle and the posterior belly of the digastric muscle. Then you have the styloid process and the styloid group of muscles. Then you have the transverse process of the atlas and the rectus capitis lateralis. Deep to the styloid process, you have the internal carotid artery in front and the internal jugular vein behind. Between the internal carotid artery and the internal jugular vein, you have the last four cranial nerves. The facial nerve, after emerging through the stylomastoid foramen, enters the gland by piercing the upper part of the posteromedial surface. Likewise, the external carotid artery lodges in the groove in the lower part of the posteromedial surface before the artery pierces the gland. Next, we'll see about the borders. So first we'll see about the anterior border. The anterior border is thin. It rests on the masseter muscle and it separates the superficial surface from the anteromedial surface. Next, we'll see what are the structures emerging through the anterior border. You have the zygomatic branch of the facial nerve, the transverse facial vessels, the upper buccal branch of the facial nerve, then you have the parotid duct. So between the upper buccal branch of the facial nerve and the parotid duct, sometimes you may have the accessory parotid gland and its duct. Then you have the lower buccal branch of the facial nerve. Lastly, the marginal mandibular branch of the facial nerve. Next, we'll see about the posterior border. So this posterior border separates the superficial surface from the posteromedial surface. So this border rests on the sternocleidomastoid muscle. Now we'll see what are the structures emerging through the posterior border. So first is the posterior auricular branch of the facial nerve. Then you have the posterior auricular vessels. So next is the medial border. So this medial border separates the anteromedial surface and the posteromedial surface. Sometimes it comes in relation with the walls of the pharynx. Then it is known as the pharyngeal border. Next we'll see about the processes of the parotid gland. So first process is the facial process. So this is a triangular projection extending forward superficial to the masseter muscle along the parotid duct. The next process is the accessory process. So sometimes a small part of the facial process detached from the main gland and it is situated between the zygomatic arch and the parotid gland. So this forms the accessory parotid gland. Then you have the pterygoid process. So this is a triangular process, extends forward from the deep part of the gland between the mandibular ramus and the medial pterygoid muscle. And next is the glenoid process. It passes upward between the external acoustic meatus and the capsule of the temporomandibular joint. So next we'll see the pre and the post styloid process. The styloid process lodges in a groove, and the gland in front of the groove is known as the pre-styloid process, which is related to the internal carotid artery. The part behind the styloid process forms the post-styloid process, which is sometimes related to the internal jugular vein. Next, we'll see what are the structures passing through the gland. The structures within the gland from outside inward are: first is the facial nerve and its branches. Then you have the retromandibular vein. Then you have the external carotid artery. Some members of parotid lymph node are also located within the superficial zone of the gland. The facial nerve, which emerges through the stylomastoid foramen, about 2.5 cm deep to the middle of the anterior border of the mastoid process. Then it passes downwards and forward about 1 cm before it pierces the posteromedial surface of the parotid gland. And within the gland, it runs forward for another 1 cm superficial to the retromandibular vein and the external carotid artery. Then it divides into two trunks, a temporofacial trunk and a cervicofacial trunk. The temporofacial trunk turns abruptly upward and subdivides into temporal and the zygomatic branches, and the cervicofacial trunk passes downwards and forwards and subdivides into buccal, marginal mandibular and the cervical branch. So the 5 terminal branches radiate like the goose foot through the anterior border of the parotid gland, and this branching pattern is known as pes anserinus. So the gland is divided into superficial and the deep part or lobes by the branches of the facial nerve, and this gland lobes are connected by the isthmus, and the gland appears H-shaped in coronal section. The branches of the nerve lie in the middle layer as a parotid sandwich, and this subdivision helps the surgeon to remove the parotid tumor, leaving the nerve intact. The retromandibular vein occupies the intermediate zone, and it is formed by the union of superficial temporal and the maxillary vein. So this retromandibular vein divides into anterior division and posterior division. Anterior division joins with the facial vein to form the common facial vein, and posterior division joins with the posterior auricular vein to form the external jugular vein. The external carotid artery occupies the deep zone, and it ascends and divides into terminal branches, the superficial temporal and the maxillary artery. The transverse facial artery, a branch of superficial temporal artery, emerges through the anterior border. Sometimes the posterior auricular artery arises within the gland. Next we'll see about the parotid duct. So this parotid duct is also known as Stenson's duct. Stenson's duct. So this is about 5 cm long and 3 mm width, and it is formed within the gland by the union of two vertical duct, and the duct emerges through the anterior border of the gland and passes at first forward on the masseter muscle between the upper and the lower buccal nerves. At the anterior border of the masseter muscle, So this duct abruptly turns medially through the buccal pad of the fat, and it pierces the buccopharyngeal fascia and the buccinator muscle. Finally, the duct passes forward obliquely between the buccinator muscle and the mucous membrane of the cheek and opens into the vestibule of the mouth on a papilla opposite the crown of the upper second molar tooth. The oblique course of the submucosal part acts as a valve and helps to prevent inflation of the duct during violent blowing. This is a diagrammatic representation to show the opening of the parotid duct in the parotid papilla in the vestibule of the mouth opposite to the upper second molar tooth. Blood supply. The parotid gland is supplied by the branches derived from the external carotid artery, veins that drain into the external jugular vein. The lymphatic drainage. The lymph drains into the superficial and the deep groups of parotid lymph node. The efferent vessels from these nodes terminates into the jugulodigastric node, which is a deep cervical node. Next, we'll see the nerve supply of the gland. The secretomotor supply of the gland is derived from both parasympathetic and sympathetic nerve. The stimulation of the parasympathetic produces watery secretion, and stimulation of the sympathetic produces mucus-rich sticky secretion. In addition, the sympathetic provides vasomotor supply to the gland. The preganglionic parasympathetic fibers arises from the inferior salivary nucleus of the medulla oblongata, passes successfully through the tympanic branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve, tympanic plexus, and from there it passes through the lesser petrosal nerve, relays in the aortic ganglion. From the aortic ganglion, the postganglionic parasympathetic fibers passes through the auriculotemporal nerve and supplies the parotid gland. The sympathetic supply comes from the sympathetic plexus around the external carotid artery, and these fibers are derived from the postganglionic sympathetic fibers from the superior cervical sympathetic ganglion. When you see the clinical anatomy related to the parotid gland, the inflammatory swelling of the parotid gland causes a very pain due to the unyielding nature of the facial capsule. Swelling of the glenoid process of the gland may be responsible for the pain during mastication. The gland may be inflamed by the retrograde bacterial infection from the mouth via the parotid duct. Mumps is a viral infection of the salivary glands, and the swollen glands do not suppurate. An inflammation of the testis or the pancreas is its occasional complications. Parotid abscess is drained by a small horizontal incision that is called as the Hilton's method. In order to avoid injury to the branches of the facial nerve, the mixed parotid tumor is a slow growing, benign, painless tumor, and this does not involve the facial nerve. So next we'll see about the Frey syndrome. Sometimes penetrating wound of the parotid gland damages the auriculotemporal nerve. So during the process of the healing, the secretomotor fibers of the auriculotemporal nerve grows out and joins with the distal end of the great auricular nerve, so through which the fibers reaches the sweat gland in the facial skin. Therefore, when the patient eats, beads of perspiration appears on the skin covering the parotid, because the stimulation intended for the salivary secretion produces the sweat secretion instead. So this is known as the Frey syndrome.